to order at, push the button, 6:05. We good, John?
Yep.
Okay. Okay, review and approve the minutes of February 9th, 2016. It's not me.
It's not.
Sorry.
Sorry.
Do I have a motion, please?
Motion. Yeah, the minutes of February 9th.
Got a motion and a second. Any discussion?
Mary did.
All those in favor? Opposed? Not able to vote? We're good to go.
Who made the motion?
I did.
Judy.
Oh, thanks.
Mm-hmm. Financial statements?
We just got them. It's nice to have them.
Robert, are we going to discuss this again?
We discussed it last week. Until I get them the day before, I'm going to keep bringing it up.
And every time you do, I'm going to tell you, I just printed these out 5 minutes before at 4:39:49. Because that's when I had time. So this is your financial report for February. You signed 24 warrants totaling $1,425.99.93 this evening. And there are a couple of issues that I'm concerned with, but I think it's just reclassification errors. We took apart the technology budgets and put them in different pockets, and I think things are getting confused as to where they're getting posted. So I need to take a look at all the individual bills and see where I budgeted to where they're getting posted. So right now, I'm not seeing anything that I'm concerned of that we haven't already talked about with our unanticipated spend placements, and that's all I have, unless anybody has any questions from last month after they thoroughly reviewed the report.
Could you give me the total on the warrants again, please?
It's $1 million.
Yep.
$425.099.93.
Okay, thanks.
No, but those warrants aren't reflected here.
Yes, every warrant that I sent you out are in the February report. They're the ones that are going to hit the February report.
Okay, so all this money that on the warrants that were signed tonight, right, are reflected in these numbers?
Yes, they are.
Okay. So the rest of it is gravy.
Great. Well, it's not. We haven't gotten to meeting season.
So you're saying we got $1,481,000. And budgeted balance as well.
Right, but nothing is, we still have months of health and life and dental insurance. Those things aren't encumbered. So.
Those aren't encumbered?
No.
How were you trying to encumber that?
We encumbered the salaries. We're working on encumbering expenses. It's not going very well.
Anyone else?
The other one just pops out at you. Why are we so over on spend subs?
Because more sped teachers are falling out sick than regular ed subs.
Are these subs being hired when they're doing ed plans? Or are the subs being called in when they have to have the team
that
meeting?
That's a question for Mr. Modesto. I don't, that's operational. What page are you looking at, Phil?
Page 3, the third, fourth line on the top.
I know that we've had an instructional assistant, a special education instructional assistant, on a long-term medical leave, and so that could be reasonable.
Okay.
Terry, so I have to answer that for you. Just making copies.
Anyone else?
Still got 4.2 million to go.
Moving along, public comment. Hi, public.
Hi.
Madam Public is here.
Report, Student Advisory Council. Caitlin Burnett, hello.
Hi. So I feel like not too much has changed since the last time I was here. Still working on that field day for closer to the end of school, making plans for that. We did get to meet with the superintendent candidates. which I think they all really appreciated, just kind of getting to talk to them. So that was nice. And other than that, I feel like nothing has really changed.
That's okay. So that field day, you're going for a half a day, full day? Are they sticking to that one period for field hour?
I think we're going to try to push for something longer.
Yeah,
see how that goes.
Good luck. Good for you. Bring it back. Thank you.
Good for you for trying. What was your impression of the superintendent candidates?
I like getting to talk to them. I think they were both like very sort of focused on what we can do better at Frontier, just in like in the school district. They were both very friendly and interested in like we had a couple seniors, and so talking about where we're going and our plans, and also getting input from some of the younger members. So I thought that was good.
Cool. Excellent. Thanks.
Anyone else? Thank you, Caitlin.
Hi.
Moving along. Unfinished business, and I will turn this over to anybody want it?
No.
Okay, so I'll turn it over to Marty, who can then turn it over to Bill.
Sure.
I'll turn it over to Patty.
And then Patty. Do a little tag team here.
Yeah, well, I'll
just going to push back and get out of the way.
So last month we met, and you had draft two of the version, which represented, I think it was about a 6.36% increase. And we had a couple of ideas of how we could trim the budget to come in with a percentage point that might be more agreeable. So the budget subcommittee did meet tonight. Bill's going to talk about that. And actually, during that budget subcommittee meeting, we made some additional changes. So Darius, I don't know if you were able to make some copies.
He did, but I don't know what he did with these staples, so please be very careful.
Yes.
Okay.
The size of the booklet's in between a regular stapler and a huge stapler, so I didn't know where the medium stapler was.
Okay.
So he made staple ribbons.
So you're going to see some pages missing, and that's on purpose, because as a result of the conversation tonight, the assessments are going to be reduced. And rather pass out incorrect information, we just removed that information, and we'll talk about the corrected information tonight. Wow.
I don't know what that is. It's like a little rabbit ears.
All right.
Yeah, nobody... it's one for binders. I see it.
Okay.
Just take a hammer and smash it down.
At least you put it on the top so I can see it.
Oh, yeah, that's a little...
You did it.
So we have our public hearing. We have invited Select Board and Finance Committee members from other towns. I am expecting them to show up. So this is our opportunity to ask questions of the Budget Subcommittee or of Patty. So I now will turn it over to Bill.
Yeah, I could explain some of this stuff to you, but then Patty's going to turn around and explain it to you again. Marty captured it pretty much in the nutshell. We had a document that we started with at 5 o'clock this evening, and we did some tinkering with it, and that's why you'll see some of the pages that you might say 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, then 6 is missing, or 7 is missing, or 8 is missing, because we made some changes to the way we're going to finance this operation, but it didn't affect the 3.69 remains the same budget item. It affected the assessments to the towns, and E&D and things of that nature, but Patty will run you all through that much more intricately than I can, so have at it.
Okay, so first I want to start with how we got from 6.6 down to the
3.69. Are we on page 6?
Yes, go to 6 of 27. You can read the other stuff at your leisure. So the things that have changed is that we have reduced one position, an English position, and I'm going to let Darius speak to that, and also an instructional assistant for $22,982. And then if you look on other operational decreases, we increased the benefits due to the elimination of that staff by $15,504. So at this point, Mr. Modesto, would you like to explain to the committee why we feel we can live without one less English teacher.
And sure.
Basically, what I'm my plan is to move a teacher from the high school to the middle school based on numbers and enrollment in the high school classes right now. And also have that English teacher teach a section of social studies. So right now I've had two teachers from the high schools going down to teach the one section of the social studies. We back up. I don't know if I'm going into too much detail, you can stop me if I am. But we need five sections of each core subject that's taught in the middle school. A teacher teaches four sections. So we need five based on keeping our class sizes between, we round 20 to 22. You know, I like 18 to 22 or 18 to 24, but we're in that area right now. And so in order to have that fifth one, I've been having high school teachers come down. So what I'm going to do is have a English teacher come down who's already taught the curriculum for eighth grade history before, and she's gonna come down and teach three Englishes and one of the social studies. The nice part about that, which I'll kind of sell them this part of it, is that she'll be down there full time. So we'll not be this transit person, which kind of breaks up the team model, which we've had a little bit of this year, having to use high school teachers to come down to the middle school. It's not a perfect, but it was a budget thing we did last year. So that's the game plan. And with the numbers in the high school right now, I think we can have class sizes, well, based on projections, we can have class sizes that would be a little bit larger for English, but not unreasonable sizes, which would be a regular high school use class. Our numbers are going to be in the mid-20s to higher 20s for about all the classes, where right now we have some mid-20, higher 20s, and then we have some teen classes based on where the schedule put different people. So, you know, that's the impact there. Additional to that impact was that we were looking at using some of this money to offset the, right now we have a math science teacher that teaches both science and math, and when he teaches more science classes than math classes, I have a problem with the number of math sections being offered. And so in order to offset, this gets really complicated, but just kind of flow with me here and I can explain it in detail with people later on if you need it. I'm going to take a current teacher who teaches health and phys ed, and I'm going to change that position because that teacher is retiring to a science health position to take the science classes so that that science teacher who's currently up there can teach, will still teach a science course because he's very good at teaching that, and he's also going to be able to teach more math, so that's going to offset that. In doing so, though, however, I'm going to have to reduce health. Okay, in the last, I think it was four years ago, mm-hmm. we increased health. We added health 3 to high school. At the time, we were teaching 8th grade family consumer science, which was kind of health, but the curriculum really wasn't health based. So what we're going to do is we're going to do 7th grade health, 8th grade health, and then health 1 and 2 in the high school and drop health 3. We met with the health department, the health teachers in the health department, about can we take the essential components of health 3 and push them down to health 1 and 2. And they feel that we can do that. They're not delighted by it because they value the whole curriculum, but I said this is kind of where we're having to force. So the cut, within this cut, we are cutting one of our requirements that we're changing to graduate. Now, explain how this all enrolls. Our current juniors who are going to be seniors still have to take health 3 because it's not fair toward their other classmates who decided to take health 3 their junior year and not their senior year in order to graduate in the way they set up courses and stuff. We have to make sure everybody graduates with the same requirements. So this will be affecting a sophomore class. The current sophomore class will now only have to take 2 years of health.
So the bottom line is, this is a response in order to maintain the wide variety of courses and have more balanced classrooms. Mr. Modesto took advantage of the fact of some teachers retiring in certain disciplines to replace them with people who have multiple certifications so that they can be more flexible in teaching outside. And that's frankly what has to happen with our smaller, more rural schools. As we face declining enrollments, et cetera, you still want to keep all of those electives and not just have to have the core courses. You have to have faculty who have those added flexibilities.
And then there's two additional instructional assistant positions that are cut within this budget as well.
But you felt you could absorb them?
We could absorb that due to the turnover in student needs who are graduating now.
The physical education component that that teacher that's teaching now is retiring, what's going to happen with that, just larger classes?
I'm hiring a phys ed, health, science teacher, all in one. And you're saying it's impossible, it's not.
I was going to say that.
Darius, are the teachers that you're talking about all on board with this suggestion from you? Or not so much you, but everybody?
They do. All the teaching staff affected by this, I've had conversations with, were they cheering for joy at their change in assignments and that kind of thing? No. But I said, cuts are going to, are exactly that. There's a aggressive in the nature of it, in the sense that we have to do some changes around it. Can we do this and still, are we taking away what we're providing? Slightly, in the sense of the health three, you're taking away that curriculum. I think the English position move, as a warning, the way our population's set up, the larger middle school classes these 2 years and the next year coming, we are probably going to have to move that position back up to the high school and may have to hire another additional English teacher in coming years. But we can get away with the way it's, I don't even say get away, we can do it this way, certainly for next year. It may be good for a 2 year plan, depending on what our enrollments are coming in, based on projection that they'll be able to find that way. So, but the health is, you are changing what we're offering curriculum wise. We're going to try to, mitigate the curricular damage of what's being delivered by, pushing the important things, what we feel is curriculum, developmentally important, into the two offerings in high school and into the eighth grade.
Are you sure that you're going to find somebody that's going to have all three of those certifications, or do you think you might want to fill one of those on a part-time position or tool?
That'll be my job, is to figure that out. But basically, that's going to be the position we're posting, because of the sections they based on the number of sections they may teach, based on the globe. A lot of the certifications are very easy to get outside of the, I'd say the science is the most difficult. After that, you can add on. And so it might be something where we have to work on waivers and stuff, but that's my headache to kind of.
Visit and health is very common.
One's getting one, they're pretty much told to get the other. And then do you have health, the extension of, the science. But I think I can do that.
So we started this exercise in creativity a couple of years ago, and it's the only way we're going to survive.
Right.
It's the only way we're going to survive, the shrinking enrollment.
If I could just say, Darius, I appreciate that you've had the conversations that were proactive. Even though they're not jumping dry, I'm impressed that you've had the conversations. So.
So I was just wondering, what's the process for setting the graduation requirements? Sure, who does that?
Well, we've had the same ones for years. The only difference has been the health, and I had come to you back 5 or 6 years ago when we increased it. So that's why Darius is bringing it.
I have to ask you to change the graduation requirements for the class of 2017. So you would have to change the class, the graduation requirement of 2018.
So right now you have to have 3 years of health to graduate.
Correct.
And you're going to go back to 2 years of health.
Correct.
What's the stake?
Well, they'll have it also in seventh and eighth grade.
Right. Okay.
So they still get the 4 years.
But that's not enough. That's not your 2 years during high school. That's only. You would take the 2 years in middle school and then two more years in high school?
Yes,
correct.
So four total years as the program at Frontier.
What's the state required?
State really doesn't have any language around that.
They have things that are in it that they require you to talk about. That they want you to be, from things that we have put in there as part of the bullying curriculum, as part of the state, I don't want to get too far and go wrong, but there's other things within preventative things that students are supposed to learn about, health preventative things, that they're written in different laws that you're supposed to cover, and we always kind of put them in health and have them kind of go that. So we have to make sure that we cover that within those 4 years. I don't think that's going to be a problem. You know, the biggest thing that Health 3 did was financial literacy. They did a big section on that, talking about how what credit card companies are doing to you and those kind of things. And they want to make sure that that's the most, they feel is the most, one of the most important components of Health 3. And they got to make sure they got to put that in Health 2. And they're going to shift everything down a little bit. And so the middle school classes are going to be, well, especially the 8th grade classes, going to pick up more content that we haven't covered in Health 1. But they're still, they haven't sat down and done that. I said, that's when we're going to use the professional development days coming up. As soon as we get the word here to do it, we're going to have to go through and realign that curriculum and decide what has to go. And
things used to be covered in family and consumer science, or sometimes in the biology curriculums. It was covered in other curriculums. And we took all of those pieces and put them in, but you're still going to have the 4 years.
While I'm thinking of it, People's United Bank is dying to come in and talk to you about financial literacy to help you out with that with their students. They have, you know, some curriculum lessons, so
yep.
She'll be contacting you.
Yep.
Maybe they'll each get a dollar for their
bank. Maybe not.
Oh, so just am I back on? I'm sorry.
Yeah, one more question.
Go ahead.
Increase in retirement benefits, is that the buyouts when people leave? The $15,354 increase?
The what?
Oh, we haven't even gotten down there yet, Bob.
Oh, I don't
jump too far, Bob.
I thought I got red.
He's talking about down here. We haven't gotten that far.
No.
Okay.
Well, I'm only hitting the highlights, so of what I changed, and that was there last time. That is our increased Franklin County retirement contribution.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay, so in order to achieve this budget, we have to do some creative financing.
Sell junk bonds?
Yeah, sure. If you go to page 19, this is what we propose to the subcommittee. We are currently sitting on $458,716 of free cash, excess and deficiency. We would like to use $185,490 to reduce the fiscal year 17 budget for the retiring teachers' costs. We would like to use $50,000 to purchase a new student information system. We would like to use $20,000 for retirement costs of our current superintendent and consider another OPEB contribution of $50,000. That would give us a projected ending balance of $153,226. So we could actually then take $100,000 and apply it towards the assessments, leaving us $53,226. The other piece of this is that I estimate I conservatively estimate our regional transportation reimbursement at 50%. And for the past 2 years, we've been in excess of $40,000. So I am going to increase my conservative estimate by $20,000. It still remains $10,000 below the governor's budget projection, so I'm comfortable with that because we don't want to get into a situation where
you're on the front page.
Where we're on the front page, exactly. So I'm comfortable with doing that. And by doing this, we are able to reduce the assessments to the towns, the increase to the towns would only be 5.82% in total.
So all we're going to have left for a rainy day fund is $53,000.
However, if I could. Yes.
Okay. Just if you can stick with me on page 19 for a minute. The reason we, as a budget subcommittee, we're recommending that you go this way because the big nut there is 185. It's because we have a whole flock of folks retiring this coming year, but they're not really recurring expenses. And if you leave them in the budget, they give you the wrong figure. Then you go comparing next year to this year, because that was in there. So we took it, we decided to recommend to take the money from E&D to pay the retirement expenses and the student information system. Retirement costs of the superintendent, we tried to talk Marty out of it, but it didn't work. So that one is still there. And the fourth one is the contribution to OPEB. We were a little skeptical and a little bit nervous about bringing E&D down to just 53, but the OPEB contribution is not something that you have to do on the 1st of July. We can do that in April, May, or June, when we see how 17 is playing out. Maybe we can't make it. You can do it. You can do it. Yes.
Well, we don't meet in August, so I would need to vote in June or September.
But you, the point is, it's not something that you have to do right off the bat. So, for all intents and purposes, you won't be extracting that money from E&D for the OPEB contribution until later on the road. It's kind of a safety valve.
So we would strike that from the motion.
So we wouldn't be recommending that you take the, do the OPEB thing right off the bat. It doesn't affect the budget. It's still 369.
So what you're going to want is, at this point in time, you want a vote to take 185,490 to reduce the assessments for the 17 budget.
No, I want a vote of...
Well, you can't do any vote until after your public hearing.
Right. I would be looking for a vote of using $255,490 from E&D to reduce the cost of the FY17 budget, purchase a new student information system, and the retirement cost of the superintendent. Then we'd be looking for a second motion for $100,000 to reduce the assessments.
Yeah.
Can I ask a question unrelated to what you're asking? What you're asking for is fine. It's about the student information system. Are there... nobody's come to talk to us about it. So are there like ongoing maintenance costs? Is there going to be a training cost? Or support of it? Like
right,
that kind of stuff?
Right now, the system that we use has high licensing fees based on number of users every year. So, and it's not friendly. It doesn't talk to the library system. It doesn't talk to the cafeteria system. So what we, and it's not what the state's calling SIF compliant. Because at some point, the state is going to stop asking us to send them data, and they're going to come in and take the data. So we decided at this point, this isn't working for us. So we did a preliminary interviewing of some different companies. So the $50,000, it's an initial cash investment that would include the implementation, the transfer of the data, the training of the staff. And then the licensing fee is going to be based on students, on the number of students every year. It's not going to be $10,000 for this module, $10,000 for this module, $10,000 for this module. So in the long run, we're going to be saving money annually with the cost of the system. But it is an initial cost outlay to purchase the software, to implement it, to transfer the data, and train the staff. And Scott Paul has a very detailed plan on how he's going to do that, and we are going out on a request for proposals to do this under the 30B law. We are required to do that.
He would like to come to your joint meeting in April.
I would love to hear it. Because I'm wondering about bandwidth costs and like, do we have any other infrastructure changes that we have to make that are associated with it?
No, we don't.
Okay.
And he can address all of that, but he has literally spent the entire year with the tech team investigating and vetting vendors and going through everything, because as Patty said, the one thing we didn't want was an additional software, even though state says we're no longer going to be compliant with this, that didn't talk to it, because that's what we have now. So
one question, Patty, up here on this page 19, it's the balance as of June 30th, is that, it says 16, do you mean 15?
I did mean 15. Thanks, Seth. You know, I intentionally make errors just so you can find them.
That's when I get the big bucks.
Right. I'm always in 3 years, last year, this year, and next year.
Right.
So just to...
So we could have money left over.
This
is my point.
Right.
That we haven't identified yet.
Right.
So...
The reason that we need to have the $50,000 now is because we need to have the money appropriated in order to put the RFP out in the street. You can't put the RFP out in the street without having money appropriated, and we want to get this done and implemented over the summer months so that come September 1st or August, whatever date we're starting, our teams will be ready to go with the databases. Ready to take attendance and enroll children and everything else, and that's why we want the money appropriated, hopefully this evening, so that we can get our RFP out on the street.
We're not going to be able to appropriate it tonight. We can vote it tonight after the public hearing if we want to go back and vote it. But the thing is, until the four towns, three to four towns approve the budget.
This isn't part of the budget. This is our E&D.
Want to transfer it?
Take it out of E&D.
Right now.
Can do that.
Because otherwise, if we didn't take it from E&D right now, all these things would be absorbed in the budget.
The motion is going to be to transfer this money into line items.
Correct.
That are going to handle this.
$255,490 total for those three items.
Yeah. You can't make those motions until after the public hearing.
No.
Those have nothing to do with the budget.
Those could happen.
You can do that right now.
Momentarily.
Did somebody just do that?
Okay.
I'll do it.
I think Phil had a question.
I'll make a motion.
Phil did it.
Yeah. I'll make the motion what Patty said.
Can you say, is it $255,490 transferred from E&D to cover the costs outlined?
Yep.
Okay. On page 19 and
27. Reduced retirement costs purchasing. It sends a student information system and Marty's care package.
And with the knowledge that we're going to get more information in April, I'd like to second that.
Okay.
Any other discussion? Judy, did you have a question?
No, I'm good. Thank you.
All those in favor?
Okay. So you can put that out in the morning.
Thank you.
Okay.
There.
That's what I was trying to get at.
That pretty much. Oh, you got more, Penny?
If we were to apportion another piece to $100,000 after we go through the public hearing, we would be able to reduce the town's assessments down to 5.82% increase in totality.
Do you want to give them a breakdown that we talked about per town?
Okay, so if I adjust the regional transportation
This is just oral, so you'll have to write it down.
Okay.
Yeah, this does not appear in print. You'll get the corrected copies tomorrow.
Well, we're going to make the motion tonight, correct?
Correct. Hopefully, when it comes time to approve the budget.
I thought it was free cash that we're taking.
No, we're not.
Okay, now we're back on the budget.
We can do the $100,000 for reduce
assessment. Nothing yet.
No, the $100,000 to reduce the assessments is part of the budget.
Yeah. Right.
So it's not part of the, we're not taking it from E&D?
We are, but as part of the budget process, not the other.
Okay.
We're doing it in two steps, Bob.
I think it's free cash that we just do whatever we want.
We're doing it in two steps.
It's almost the same time.
Clear as mud.
They were the
Judy, can I just hear the dollar amount again that you said?
$255,490.
Of those four items?
Three.
No. Oh, just the three.
We're going to wait on the 50
options.
We're going to wait on the 50.
It's just not making sense. Okay, I'm just
We can still do the
move
50
on,
later.
Proceed.
But
got it. I'm good.
Okay.
I voted on it. And
that's the plan.
That's the plan.
What we voted could cover before.
If we approve the budget at the 3.69%, the effect it will have on the end, and we apply $100,000 of free cash, and I adjust the regional transportation estimate, the increase to the individual towns is as follows. Conway will increase $90,624, or 8.18%. Deerfield will increase $287,614, or 8.55%. Sunderland would increase $28,458, or 1.64%. And Waitley would increase by $9,201, or 0.99%.
I forgot to ask in there, where are we in terms of the Mulary and Curley budgets, the Senate, the House, and the governor?
We're only at the governor's.
So we have no idea. Nothing.
I was told on Friday to expect the governor's budget March 13th.
And that one never.
We got the governor.
That one never makes
not
it to
with
the.
Any changes.
Oh, okay.
That one never makes it to the printer.
Right.
Because the Senate has a shot at it.
And the House does, right.
Hey, all we need is a couple of big snowstorms and they'll put it back in all the
chimneys. March what? Is that 13th?
Well, maybe through town meeting.
We are not going to have a couple of snowstorms. Oh, not
now,
this year.
Is anybody, in the board's behalf discussed these with the finance committee? So that they have an idea of the town administrators as to what your recommendations were going to be tonight.
No. For us.
No, you're first. You're first before.
I just wanted.
We'd like to know at least for us.
We wouldn't tell anybody before we told you.
That's why we invite them to this public hearing.
I just I'm wondering, because you're asking for 8.55% in Deerfield, and I, you know, their monies are tight.
Assessment increase. Okay, it's more a function of the numbers than it is.
Well, I know what the problem is. It dealt with the number of students and how it works.
The minimum contribution for Deerfield went up $125,517 for Frontier. So your minimum local contribution is being assessed higher because of your property and the personal wealth of the town.
Is that in here, Pat?
No. Yeah.
Yes.
It's on the pages that aren't there, probably, Billy.
No, it's in there.
Yeah.
No, it's
page 26 or 27.
Yeah. This addresses the percentage.
This is the local minimum contribution changes. And this is just a piece of the local minimum contributions for Frontier for these towns. They have two other pieces, the part for their elementary and the part for their Franklin County tech assessment. And so this is only the piece that is applicable to Frontier.
That's formula driven. That's half of Deerfield's increase.
Right.
And that's formula driven. That is out of our control. Completely.
I mean, since you brought up Deerfield, I mean, first I just want to say to the Deerfield people here and to Patty, well done on the roof and the dead override vote. That was impressive.
Yeah.
And the number, the percentage, 4-1, 3.5, 4-1. I mean, that's the level of support that's there on a debt override vote. So get the people, get your people to vote. Come.
For the most part, those people don't typically show up in a town meeting.
That's because they haven't been personally asked by you.
You got to go to the senior center more, Bob.
We got anything else?
I know, but you know, I don't really want to belong to the senior center. I don't think I'm quite there yet.
Just start getting younger.
Okay, does anyone have anything else, or can we? Are we done for this so we can move along and get reports?
Yeah, let's do the reports now instead of waiting till later.
Instead of waiting.
20 minutes.
This is crazy. We never have 20 minutes.
Now, do we have any new educational incentives in here? Anything
Say
positive
no.
that we're going to add?
Moving along.
There are additions in there. I mean, we talked about that last time, the addition of 0.4 to create full-time psychologists.
Yeah.
And then addition to several line items to round out some areas we've overspent, and not overspent, but
on budget.
On line items within the budget for $6,000. Okay. So I believe those are the only two.
I didn't hear the question, Eric.
So is there any additions to it?
No. There's no initiatives. We're building capacity for our incoming students by increasing the psychology services by 0.4. But that's because we've got children coming up in grade 6 and grade 5 that are going to need, we're going to need that additional.
Well, you also got rid of an adjustment counselor last year that was never replaced. So this is also a response to that.
My interest is piqued with as to what we're doing. Relative to that, are we doing everything we need to do education-wise, filling all the needs that need to be plugged in.
Right. All of the budgets that we have created for this year maintain the level of services that we have. There are no new initiatives in the district. I do not call increasing our daily sub rate from $65 to $75 an initiative, but that is really the only new thing other than the 0.4 psychologist for the for Frontier. So Mr. Baker, how are you?
Good.
We have
seats
over there for the audience.
We don't usually have them at the table.
I would have let you eat at my table there, Bob.
Well, it's just because we have so many.
Don't start. You never know how many are going to show up.
That's true.
So we're going to move along into the reports. The collaborative, Lynn is not here, so we'll be skipping that tonight. So we'll have the principal's report. Maybe.
Somewhere here.
You want to come back to your hand?
You got out already?
Yeah.
I have principals. I have superintendent.
Superintendent. Yeah. I don't have principals.
No. Nope.
Yes, we do. You live in the other room?
I did 15 copies, and I felt like it was 5 there.
Mary says, was I supposed to pass these around?
Yes.
This is the enrollment. We got the enrollment.
I brought those.
You brought those.
Yeah.
But it felt like I know I did 15, why I'm looking frantic, because I know I made 15 copies of it, and I feel like there's only about 10 in that pile I ended up. So you're there.
Cindy,
all right, it's, I mean, it's the meat of tonight, the budget. Basically, last week we had a very successful high school orientation. We bring the eighth grade parents in to talk about high school and planning for 4 years. And we also did another night of AP information night, where the AP teachers meet with parents as well to discuss the requirements of AP courses, why you should take an AP course, and the challenges within that. Again, I'm continuing to publicize it. We have a public meeting here that next Tuesday is my sixth grade parent night here for the new seventh grade parents. And I'm going to offer another coffee and conversations to get them parents who are interested to come during the school day like I did before, because we had good turnout. I don't know if I'll get the same amount of turnout if we're going to hit everybody, but that's the game plan there. MCAS is coming up on March 22nd, 23rd, and 24th. We are changing the format slightly this year. In the past, we've done three delayed openings. Because they have changed the middle school assessment, there's no longer a long comp in the middle school. We don't need to do 3 days of delayed openings. We can do it the first 2 days, and then the third day, it's just one test for the 10th grade, and we can cover that with the staff. And the reason, the reason we do a delayed opening is the number of test sites in our building. Because it's not just classes of 20, we also have small groups and individual testing. While we could possibly pull it off with a very complex schedule, it really is hard to test half the school and have half the school kind of going, bouncing around and that kind of thing. So we do that delayed opening. The building is open in the morning, the library is open, the gym, the workout areas were open, and some teachers, especially AP teachers, are doing AP review for the upperclassmen, 11th and 12th at the time. So there are stuff. So we run only one bus line, the early bus for the students. It's those who want to arrive late can get the professor and transportation. Right. Any questions on that? So it's just a little change, but.
Does GRIPCO need to know about that?
What's that?
Do you need to notify GRIPCO?
It doesn't change anything with GRIPCO. You still need the regular morning run. Okay. And I'll do the robocalls and all that good stuff. It's already posted on our website. Thursday is our annual student faculty basketball game. Come watch us live our glory days.
Are you playing?
I'm going to try. We're out of shape every year. And then I want to get on people's radar. Our annual music telethon happens before our next meeting, because we have a joint meeting in April. And that's just a tremendous event to stop in and see. This year they're going to do a lot. They're going to combine some cabaret performances with the telethon as well. So kind of those two events kind of bring it to one, and I know they're working hard at that, so I wanted to put that on the radar there. I know what's not on here is probably everybody did receive an email regarding that we did have an incident in the building yesterday morning, a fire in a boys' bathroom. I know Ms. Barrett reached out to all of you. It is under investigation, so I don't want to give much details to it. I will say that the staff reacted wonderfully. The students as a whole, besides whoever was responsible, acted wonderfully and when we had to move them out, we were together in the building. I want to thank Deerfield Fire as well, South Deerfield Fire Department, because they did quickly open up the other side of the building because it was cold out, and so they made sure they secured the building and were able to get students back in relatively quickly. I mean, we were 20 minutes they were out there for, which is a pretty good turnaround time, so I was happy with that. So that's what I have in a quick mention.
Thank you. Questions?
No question, comment. I went to AP Information Night. I found it extremely helpful. Really nice review of the curriculum. Nice to meet the teachers. Yeah. Thumbs up.
Good deal. Sure. Thank you, Judy. Superintendent.
Sure. So, as many of you know, we've had the Department of Education here yesterday, today, and tomorrow. I had informed you that back in November and December, we had uploaded hundreds and hundreds of pages of documents for district self-assessment. And about 3 weeks ago, we were informed that they were only coming to audit Frontier, that they would not be auditing the elementary schools as well. So we were relieved on that. When I asked the likelihood of them auditing the elementary schools, they said very unlikely. So I appreciate any school committee who have met with them I know we've been asking a lot of you this year, so much appreciation goes to that. We should get a report from them on our areas of strength and areas that we need to look at, probably within 6 to 8 weeks. So, on Friday, March 4th, I had the opportunity with other superintendents to meet with 16 legislators, 4 state senators, and 12 state reps. It's nice to have them in a captive, as a captive audience when you're serving food, and you get to ask them all sorts of questions. And my big continual concern is the lifting of the charter caps and the allocation of school choice dollars. So we also talked about regional transportation. We also talked about our concerns for early education, because we are seeing more and more students with severe special needs coming in as 3- and 4-year-olds. We're also seeing a prevalence of students who are in private daycare and private preschools being kicked out of those for behavior issues and then becoming a burden on the elementary schools. So it is affecting all of our budgets, and these were questions that we wanted to make sure that were on their radar. In addition, I thank Phil for making copies of an article that was in the Recorder, I think a week ago. Mike Bonacani, who's the superintendent for Mohawk Schools, has formed a rural consortium. We're meeting for the first time on March 23rd. And the reason for that is, as I explained to you before, we are seeing, even though we're considered a desirable district and we have a 3-to-1 ratio of students who choose our district as opposed to losing, for the first time this year, because of the funding formula for charter, we are losing more revenue than we are taking in. So if as a desirable district, we are topsy-turvy with numbers, I can't imagine how it's affecting students or faculties and administrators of districts who have the exact reverse. So what he's proposing is a model that's coming out of Wisconsin, bless you, that gives a differential to rural schools. Right now we're getting $20 a year increase from the state for student expenditures. It to me is really laughable amount of money that we're getting. And this proposal says for those districts who should be kind of held harmless through no fault of their own for losing students, is there an additional amount? So I'll be curious and I'll report back on that. I also wanted to let you know that we continue with our contract negotiations, our policy subcommittee meetings, and I know everyone's relieved that there is a superintendent's replacement. I know you guys have put in hours and hours and hours of work, so thank you very much for all of that. And I did just want to give you an update. The Mass Department of Public Health did conduct an assessment on February 25th. We expect to get a full report sometime in the beginning of April. And the director of the organization said that he would be happy to come and speak to the school committee when he gets those results. So that's what I have. So you would like that, it sounds like? Okay, so when I get the results, I will inform our chair. And we may need, because our joint meeting in April is a joint meeting, and we have some other presenters, and I don't think it's appropriate for the entire committee to have just a quick separate meeting for that issue only. Okay?
Marty, I do agree with that, that it would not be appropriate for the joint meeting.
Right, right. So.
A separate joint meeting?
Well, a separate regional meeting. As a region, you own the building.
Yeah. Okay.
So, okay. Anything else?
Okay, because a public hearing starts at 7 and it's actually 5 minutes off, I'm going to call a 5-minute recess. And does anybody, well, I can do a roll call.
You don't need a roll call.
No, you're just,
I'm just taking a little recess, folks. Okay. All right, everybody go, stretch their legs. Okay, so we're calling back from recess, and welcome to our public hearing for our proposed FY17 budget. So, as you may or may not know, I'm Cindy Womat, chair, and the good news is I'm not on the budget committee, so I get to turn this over to our chair of the budget committee, Mr. Bill Smith.
You have in front of you the document, and if you know, you may have looked at it already and seen there are pages missing. Because we met at the budget subcommittee, met at 5 o'clock, and did some more work on this budget. So things have changed since since this, you will get, the towns will get the new stuff tomorrow morning, but we haven't, that was only an hour and a half ago that we did this. So we will go through the changes with you tonight, and you'll have the actual, you'll have the printed pages tomorrow. But what you're looking at, if you look and see, like, I think it's number six, page six is missing. So if you're flipping through and you go, what did they do on page five? That's why, because we didn't want to give you a document with the wrong information in it, because we made some changes. We will tell you what those, Patty will walk you through it step by step, so you'll know what they all are, the changes that are made to the budget.
Do you need a copy?
Yeah, I think I just...
Oh, no, I only have one copy.
I think that's probably...
They didn't give one to Lynn.
Head for page 6 and 27.
Yeah.
And Patty will start us at the top.
I was there last time.
So 6 and 27, we start with what our net school operating budget assessed to the towns was last year, which was $9,747,730. And though we do not have a negotiated collective bargaining agreement, we do honor the steps, which will cost $55,036. We are increasing our psychologist services by a 0.4 FTE, which will cost $30,810, and that is due to an increased need with the sixth graders that are matriculating. We have some funding changes that we had to make with our school budget, which added $126,934, and I'll go through that in more detail on another page. And same thing with our tuition revolving, $38,496. We have, for the first year time, a large increase in our health insurance, which is 6.18%. And we have a contingency for contract negotiations, and that totals $276,749. We are eliminating one FTE English teacher, which would save us $63,065. We are eliminating an instructional assistant, $22,982. And we are hoping to have salary savings in our salary accounts due to retirements, the attrition of the retirements with new hires coming in at a lower scale of $63,237. For the first time, we need to put in a line item for charter tuitions of $69,788. Our school choice in and charter out are upside down at this point. Our out-of-district sped tuitions will increase $2,957. And our requirement for to the Franklin County retirement increased $15,354. We do have some decreases. The benefits due to the elimination of the above-mentioned staff would save us $15,504. We have a decrease in our legal fees of $8,500 and decrease in retirement costs of $83,450. This brings us a net change of 3.69%. And the way that we are able to achieve this is through the usage of our excess and deficiency. But before we go there, I'd like you to take a peek at pages, page 18 of 27. And this is where we are with our school choice and charter. Because we are a regional, we have to pay out as well as receive money. We're on the town side, the schools get the benefit of the money and the town gets the benefit of paying the out number. Up until this year, we've always had more revenue than we had expenses. This year, we're projected to be short $69,788, and that is because in the governor's budget, one, the state charter aid went from $150,767 this year to $51,504, which is almost $100,000 difference. And our charter tuitions are going up $19,454. So we are bringing in projected $929,664, but going out $999,452. So it puts us in a position this year that we're going to be short about $57,916. But we do have circuit breaker funds that we can reappropriate these monies to. And in FY17, we need to add to our budget the $69,788 in the excess charter that we talked about. And that increases the budget about 2.02%. So if you go to page 19 of 27, these are items that would have appeared in our budget. We have retirement costs for FY17 of $185,490 for retiring teachers. We need to purchase a new student information system for $50,000. And we have to cover the retirement costs of our current superintendent in the amount of about $20,000. That totals $255,490. And we have $458,716 in our free cash, in our excess and deficiency. Prior to this meeting, the school committee, prior to this public hearing, the school committee did vote to appropriate the $255,490 to keep that money off of the budget. And we will retain $153,226 in our excess and deficiency. The second recommendation I have made to the subcommittee and to the full board is that we use $100,000 to free the excess and deficiency to offset the assessments, as well as the fact that I very conservatively estimate the regional transportation reimbursement. And in the past 2 years, we've been able to carry $40,000 over each year due to those conservatives. And you guys, the towns get the credits for that in the next year. So if I increase my estimate by $20,000 and apply $100,000, then the assessments to the towns become more manageable and will only increase a total of 5.82%. Now that's the information that is not contained in this document because we just discussed it 20 minutes before our regular meeting started. But I can verbally tell you that if the committee votes to appropriate an additional $100,000 towards the assessment, Conway's assessment would go up $90,624. Or 8.18%. Deerfield would go up $287,614, or 8.55%. Sunderland's would increase by $28,458, or 1.64%. And Whately would increase $9,201, or 0.99%. So overall, the assessments would increase 5.82%.
Want to
now if you look at page
just come up for air for a second and see if anybody has any questions on where we are so far.
Could you just for everybody's benefit, could you identify yourself, because not everybody knows everybody.
Sure. Jim Bosman from the Finance Committee in Conway. Patty, you said that the reduction in the charter from the $100,000 reduction, you said that was in the governor's budget?
Yes.
So, but isn't it, I mean, we'll see that budget gets beat up.
Right, but I can only use the numbers that I have at this time.
Scott Bergeron, town of Sunderland. What's the total draw on E&D that's being recommended, and what percentage of above 5% did you have E&D that did not require the town's approval?
We weren't in excess of the 5%, okay. So we had the 458 in the account at the end of the year. And what was your second question,
Scott? The first question was, what's the total draw on E&D to support the budget that you're
proposing? What was the total draw?
We're going to take $255,000 that would have appeared in the budget for those items. The $185,000 for retirement.
Yep.
The $50,000 for the new student service
information system.
Yep. And the $20,000 for the contract and of our superintendent.
Thank you.
And now we're talking about what the school committee is now going to deliberate is whether they want to take an additional $100,000 and put it towards the assessments. If they do, and I change my regional transportation, then those will be the assessments. But what else? I just want to point out that if you go to page 26 to 27, I just want to show you the difference in your contributions. So when we say that Conway's assessment is going up $90,624, well, $32,606 is because your minimum contribution went up. Same thing with Deerfield, $287,614, but your required contribution went up $125,517. On the flip side, Sunderland is only going up $28,458, and yet your minimum contribution decreased $28,340, so that, like, you're at zero there. And then the same thing with Waitley, they're going up $9,201, but they also had a decrease in their minimum contribution of $3,687. And I just want to make clear to the members of the towns, this minimum contribution that piece that you're seeing here is only your Frontier piece. It does not include your elementary and your Franklin County Tech pieces of your minimum requirement.
And Scott, I'm sure you know this because you've been around for doing this for a little while, but those numbers that Patty was just talking about, those are formula driven.
Oh yeah, I understand.
By the state, the formula the state of Massachusetts yep. gives us. Those yep. numbers are not within the control of the 11 of us.
No, I recognize that. My the line of my questioning wasn't necessarily about the minimum contribution, but it was about the aggregate use of E&D below the 5%, which is kind of the guideline.
And I was yeah. looking we, to see we've never, we don't there. Have the luxury of being in the excess of the 5%.
I recognize.
But we're really, we're kind of cleaning it out this okay. year to try to make this thing go.
Again, understood. Thank you.
Okay. I think that, Patty, you got it all?
Nope, that's it.
You got it all, okay.
Any more questions?
Skip's in the back.
Just a quick one, since we don't have the budget, it is a little difficult, but is there another hearing at some point in time?
You do have the budget. You have what you have is the budget.
You don't have the assessment data. The budget, you got the budget.
You have the budget. You don't have the assessment.
You don't have the assessment data because we monkeyed with it an hour ago.
And I
just couldn't get it that fast.
And I will get that to the town administrators in the morning.
3 points. The 3.69 budget increase was not affected by anything we did in the back room. That was money assessment. Money we used to reduce the assessments. The budget stayed the same. It was 3.69 to 5 o'clock, and it's still 3.69. That hasn't changed. That's why you have it printed in front of you. The other part, we changed it.
Right. So, Skip, everything that you have in front of you is correct.
Okay.
It's the missing pieces that will be sent out tomorrow that will add and clarify some of your confusion, perhaps.
Just for the benefit of the Conway delegation that's here, could you explain a little bit about the concept of the fifth year?
Is that included yes. in here? I think
yeah,
on...
Yeah, Phil is very. That's a good number.
24 of 27.
Look on page 24, and you will see the. We do. Can I do? I'll do.
Yeah,
that.
You can do.
We do the budget based on a five-year average of enrollment. If you look at this page, and you look out the year that was dropped, as opposed to the class that came in, you see the numbers are big. There's a big change. Look at Waitley's, for example. 2015, the class is 60, and the year that we dropped off was 92. It's just a function of the number of kiddos there are in Waitley. And the same thing happened in Conway. You went from 70, you dropped off 75, you take in 82. It changes their number. Deerfield's was exactly the same, 249 for 249. Sunderland had a big change. You dropped off 145 as the fifth year, and you only brought in 117 students. So it makes the enrollment numbers get skewed by the five-year average, but that was we did that years ago because it sort of helps to take out some of the highs and lows. These are peculiar years because the populations in the towns are doing funny things.
I guess that's the point that was really good to make, that one yeah. of the reasons Conway's paying more is because there's mm-hmm. more kids.
Right. Minimum contribution for Conway and this number on this page is what drives theirs. Half of Deerfield's increase is driven by minimum contribution, which is formula driven, out of our control. The student ratio is a wash. It's 249 in, 249 out. The rest of theirs comes from the formula.
10% more students.
More questions? Sure.
It may be in there, and I just didn't see it. School choice. What's the school choice enrollment?
We'll get you on the right page. It is in there.
Is that 18?
I don't have the enrollments in there.
Oh, you don't?
Yeah.
Oh, I have seen them along the way. That's
I just saw them on the internet.
Did you get them tonight?
Yeah, you did. I just passed them out.
Another sheet?
Yeah, your attendance, Bob.
Or the October 1st school start.
There's 123 students right now, and I want to say it was the number was 132 for some reason that's sticking in my head.
I have the big document. So currently, perfect. Frontier has 129 school choice students coming in, and going out, we have 88 as choice and charter combined. So we actually, so to make it clear, the way the funding formula works, we're taking in 129, we're sending out 88, and we owe money, the way it's set up. So it's kind of, it doesn't make sense that we made a good school district, both, you know, the elementaries and the high school, and middle and high, yet we get funding, that's the proper word to say on television, we get, you know, kind of,
let me say it?
Yeah, we can kind of get screwed over by how the method works. And, you know, we provide an excellent education here, and yet we pay more money so someone can go to a charter school down the street that, you know.
This is kind of why everywhere we go, superintendents meetings, principals meetings, and everywhere else, we've been talking about charter schools. Governor Baker is a great proponent of expanding the charter school cap, because where all the votes are in the legislature is from 495 East. We don't have enough votes out here to bring the money back to us, because they don't do choice in Boston. They don't have to. So they don't care, they could care less. Then we take in it's a 3-to-1 ratio in our school, right. And we're losing money.
Right, every charter student is 18,500 approximately.
Right.
And so for every charter student we come in, I have to try to, every charter school that goes out, I have to try to recruit for school choice to make up that dollar.
That's been $5,000 per student for school choice since day one, has never changed. Charter schools can charge you any blessed thing they like for tuition. And you pay it.
Of the 88 students going out, how many are charter and how many are choice? Certainly.
And he has the numbers by town, too.
Okay, yeah. And so charter going out, the subtotal is we have 36 charter going out and 52 choice going out. And if you want it by town, for charter going out, Conway, 3. Deerfield, 3. No, that can't be right.
It's bigger than that.
Thank you.
I was looking at just one.
Yeah, we're missing a number.
While Darius is looking at that, just let me elaborate a little bit further. The way that the original charter agreement was set up was that for the first year that a student left, let's say Frontier, that school, in order to figure out how to deal with less students, would get 100% reimbursement. So if the cost of the tuition was $18,500, you would get a reimbursement of that. And for the next 4 years, you would get 25%. But just like regional transportation, where we are supposed to get 100% reimbursement, we're getting this convoluted amount, so that even though we have more students coming in than we have going out, that's what I was talking about, a reduced revenue. And it's extremely frustrating because there doesn't seem to be much that we can do about it other than to shout it from the rooftops to our political.
Do you have that, Patty, the number in front of you, what the 33 charges cost us?
I had it,
but it's not in this pile of paper.
Let's do this. Conway has 16 children, 6 in school choice, 10 in charter. Their choice number is 35,311. Their charter number is 183,730. Deerfield, you have 33 students going out, 17 by choice, 16 by charter. Your choice costs us 116,667, and your charter costs 291,380, for a total of 408,047. Sunderland, you have 25 children, 19 choice, 6 charter, for a total of 25. The choice costs 115,607. The charter costs 108,286. Waitley has 14 children, 10 choice for charter. Their choice costs $55,619 and their charter costs $73,398. So the total choice out is $323,204 and the total charter out is $656,794 for a total of $979,998, $1 million, leaving Frontier Regional to educate our children elsewhere.
And 33 of those kids are the charter kids, and cost you almost $700,000 for those
36.
36, excuse me.
And is it? Is it fair to say that most of those charter students that are going out were charter students that went out of the elementary schools as well?
Well, charter schools enrollment for the most part is at the high school level.
I meant choice.
They often, just as we do not admit very many students on the middle school and high school level with choice, most of ours come in as elementary. I don't know that it's exactly the same ratio going out at the secondary level.
About when they start?
Yeah.
No, we're not getting a big drop-off going
into seventh grade, right.
Why students choose neighboring districts for whatever reasons. Some are actually closer to other high schools. I mean, there's parts of Conway, there it's three down the street to go to Mohawk, mm-hmm. and we have a few that choose that. I mean, going through the list, there's the numbers. Sometimes there is differences with the school itself. But most of it is some kind of convenience factor, or grass is greener. There's not a lot that I know that are leaving in disgust to go look for better opportunities.
While putting this analysis together, I did notice that we do lose a good number of our sixth graders to charter.
Charter, yeah.
So they're choosing charter at the sixth grade. Went for 7 through 12. They're choosing charter. So when Darius and I are looking at our fifth and sixth grade enrollments, we've got to now consider that factor about to how that's going to affect our own enrollment. And the other thing that I did, just so everyone knows, is that regardless that we can calculate each town's costs, because our regional agreement does not talk about this, this is assessed by your things, so your percentages. So Waitley, who's got a very small piece, is picking up Deerfield share. And Sunderland is also, sharing their costs. It's getting caught. It's not allocated properly in the assessments because our regional agreement does not address it.
Sure.
I think one of the things that's important is that, this is not charter school bashing. This is charter school financing bashing.
Mm-hmm. True.
And that there's a big difference because people are perfectly, it's perfectly legal to take your kid and put him or her in charter school, and you can't get upset with people for following the law. But the financing scheme is completely broken, and it's not just that, it's what an assault on the town meeting prerogative. And the fact that our town meeting education dollars are being spent without our oversight, without our input, without anybody having to answer a single question about a single penny that they spend.
Because we're shipping off kids to four or five different charter schools. Do you see any of those charter school superintendents coming to a town meeting to explain to you what they're doing with their money? Don't have to.
Well, you ask, they won't. They don't come. They won't. They don't have to.
I would also add that in the same context, the prior 8 years of prior administration had the same expansion methodology. It's not exclusive to this particular administration. I don't say that politically. I say that as we talk about the current status.
Right. There's somebody in the back been waving at us.
Hi. I'm going to ask a really stupid question.
Can you tell us who you are?
Oh, my name is Doug Finn, town of Deerfield.
Thank you.
Really stupid question. We're paying, the number was about $18,000 for a student who chooses or charters out.
No. Charter.
Just charters out. Okay. And a student who comes into the district, $5,000?
Right. That's a choice.
Gets?
A choice student.
Choice student. So do we lose $5,000 for a choice student that goes out?
Yes.
So that actually is an equitable balance.
Correct.
If we have the same number of students choicing in as choicing out, no worries.
Correct.
Correct.
It's really the, so it's just the funding for the charter.
Charter is what tips the wheelbarrow over.
Okay, exactly. Very good. And one other question, if, hypothetically, if everyone in Deerfield, those 33 families in Deerfield currently either send their kids out by charter or by choice to other schools in other districts, if they all chose to return their kids to this school next fall, would the assessment change?
Yes.
Or would it take a year for the assessment to change, or is that?
Well, it would take a year. It would take at least six months for the numbers to change.
Okay.
The budget has to go with what we've got at the time.
Fair
but
enough.
Those 33 children coming back would save us $408,047 going out, but we would probably need a piece of that to add staff for the 33 children coming back in. So it's not a dollar to dollar.
The only option the towns have in regard to the exodus of the kids is you could vote to not to participate in school choice, but that only stop them from coming.
Right.
You cannot stop them from going. You cannot. If you don't participate in school choice, it only stops kids from choosing into Frontier. You cannot stop them from leaving. You cannot stop them from chartering out. That's why almost all school districts, except for the inner ones in Boston, who don't need to, metropolitan districts, they have to participate in school choice. You have to balance the loss.
Sure.
You have no choice. You've got to try to attract kids to replace the ones who are leaving. But you cannot, there's no legal mechanism. We cannot, you as a town or us as a school district, school committee, can't stop them from leaving.
And the last question, is there any action at the state level currently to change the way charter schools are funded?
It's under committee review right now. Senator Rosenberg seems to be supporting holding the cap. His fear is that if we lift the cap and more charter schools are formed, it's going to reduce town budgets or school budgets even further. I think whether it's an intentional or unintentional consequence that this would be the demise of public education. You cannot continue on the trajectory that we are. And I will tell you too, Phil's very kind about charter schools. I do understand that our argument is with the funding formula. However, the original reason the charter schools were formed was so that kids could get something different than what they're currently getting in their neighborhood schools. I do not have a problem with schools who have Chinese immersion that we have down the road, or the performing arts, things that a traditional high school, college prep high school, may not be able to address in the same percentage. I do have a problem with schools who try to replicate a college preparatory program. I do have a problem when ads are on TV showing students saying, I go to such and such charter school in Springfield, you get a private education at no cost to your parents. I have a real problem with that concept. And so I have a real problem with the way the funding formula is. And I think if it's not addressed, that we're just gonna see this continual trickle-down effect, and we're gonna see this pitting of town services and schools for some time.
And going back to whether or not it's being changed, I'll go back to the point I tried to make earlier. We've had Steve Gulick in here several times trying to hold his feet to the fire, but that's one man representing, 14 towns? You go east of 495, you've got one town with 14 representatives. He's in a box that he cannot get out of. We don't have the manpower out here in the West to make him pay attention. So that's why we end up stuck in this. Hi, Paul.
Quick question. What are we doing to sell the value of Frontier versus competition? Maybe it's saying I just haven't seen it or haven't read it. How aggressive can Frontier be in terms of comparatives?
Marketing itself.
And in terms of letting taxpayers know how much money is going out, and for the average homeowner in all of our towns, what does it cost that average home to see these kids going out? Those kind of numbers, I haven't seen them, but I think they would be, that would be an eye-opener.
It's kind of like one of the dirty little secrets of choice and charter.
people don't realize it, but they're beginning to, because we're not the only district that's, we've been fortunate at a 3-to-1 ratio, but this is the first time we've been upside down. But we are now. We're paying out more than we're taking in. So everybody's digging, because there's more and more towns and districts that are in the same mess that we're in there. They've gone upside down with choice and charter, and we've got to fix it or we're going to drown.
Paul, just to answer your question a little bit, it's sort of a very sensitive subject because, you know, years ago when I was principal here, we did radio ads on choice. And it never really felt very good to me because we did it sort of at the backs of our neighbors. Gil Montague, Greenfield, they send over 100 students from those two towns. And as the superintendent there calls it, skimming off the top of their students to their neighboring schools. So, you know, I sort of feel like we have to be in this collectively. And I don't really have a beef with the charter schools per se. If they are fulfilling a need that other schools can't fulfill, I don't have a beef with it. I have a real beef with the funding formula. And I have a real beef with lifting the cap. So I don't want to pit people against, you know, neighbors against neighbors and communities against communities.
Well, I know you don't want to do that. But when we're looking at $1 million,
I know,
getting out the door, I think the hand's been played. I think that's, you know, I admire you for having to try to stay above the fray,
mm-hmm.
but when the shells are incoming the way they are, it's time to circle the wagons and try to do something proactively instead of sitting at these meetings going over these ridiculous numbers. And the average taxpayer is just going, the money's just going off the door.
We've been distributing, Patty had put together cost in and cost out with real dollars in real towns. And I've been giving them to the state legislators, anybody who will listen to me. And I think it might be, you know, if there's some way we could get that. And that doesn't express an opinion. All it does is it gives the facts of what is actually happening. And also keep in mind that with a Franklin County population dwindling everywhere, we're all vying for the same small pile of students that's getting increasingly smaller. But I think perhaps giving, you know, a factoid sheet out to people, because I would be willing to bet that most parents of students who go to charter schools don't have a clue what the cost is or who's absorbing that cost.
And we're also, I mean, the Massachusetts rural school, the superintendent.
Right, consortium, yeah.
And that's, I don't know if you saw in the Recorder last week and the editorial in the Recorder today, I think, about the political advocacy that the similarly situated rural schools of under 1,000, which are most of Western Mass, are forming a political advocacy organization or a political action committee type of organization to specifically advocate for the charter school funding rehabilitation, because that argument is not being made right now in Boston by any of the statewide educational.
And please don't think it's that Marty's not being proactive or the school is not being proactive. We've been on this for a long time. It's just now it's coming to that head, so to speak, where this is the first year, but nobody in Boston is listening to us. And all the superintendents, Marty just went to a meeting on March 4th, another meeting, not the first meeting. So we are not being reactive. We are trying to be proactive, but it's kind of up against a concrete wall.
Just curious, Marty, you had said cost of attendance for outgoing. How widely known is it, the cost of attendance here in the district? What's the cost of attendance?
The cost of what?
Attending. Cost of attendance here. I mean, we talk about cost of attendance elsewhere.
Right.
What is it here? Is that in the budget? Does the populace know that it's, and I'll make a number up, $2 to go to Frontier? Does this group know?
It'd be lovely if it were.
I understand. Does this group know what cost of attendance is?
Of our per pupil expenditure?
Yeah.
I don't know. Do you all have a sense of that? It's between 13 and 14,000.
Yeah, I thought we talked about it last year.
I think that's an important number to have out there.
as we talk about, well, maybe it's $18,000 or to a vocational school that has a specific program, you have to pay the full cost of retail. I get all that. But if it's 13,000, I think I just heard.
Yeah, a little 13 and change.
Yeah, 13 and change to go here. That's a real number people should understand as well. Mm-hmm. And that the district shouldn't be afraid to put out there.
Yeah.
But one of the things that it's involved in our cost is the special ed cost.
We do get some aid for it,
but the charter schools, for the most part, don't have any special ed students.
Sure.
Because they can select only the cream of the crop. They will not take, to my knowledge, a marginal student.
Well, we just heard that about skimming from other towns, so right. I think that point's a bit disingenuous.
The choice is if you get exceed your choice numbers, it's done by lottery.
I understand.
Everybody wants to come in, you throw the names in the hat, this one, you're in, and the rest of you, sorry. Charters don't have to do that.
But as we talk about formulas, it's also a bit disingenuous to say there couldn't be a fix for the choice formula as well. If the cost of attendance tracked with the kid, done. We wouldn't be having the discussion.
Right.
So by choicing someone in here, it's an operating deficit for that student to attend from that town. The district towns underwrite that education, just like we do going out. So again, if cost of attendance is what we're going to talk about, make it a universal formula discussion. That's just great financing.
And I don't disagree with you at all.
I just don't want it lost in the noise.
Right. But I, you know, heard Steve Pulick say,
I know,
we're never going to discuss it, Marty. Right. It is a non-issue.
Isn't that really frustrating?
It's very frustrating.
The statewide trends are in all the wrong directions. There's a ballot initiative that got certified to lift the cap. And part of the legislative solution that's going on is actually trying to meet and mollify those initiative sponsors to see what will it take for you to drop your initiative, which is, you know, and will you take only 100 new charter schools instead of the 200 that your initiative will create?
I recognize the frustration that we all are in with respect to how the different forms of, quote, public education, unquote, are covered. But if we got around the funding formula universally, and again, talked about cost of attendance here, Sunderland Elementary, Conway Elementary, all the schools, if everybody knew those costs, we probably would be a little bit more open in the dialogue, and maybe that parent somewhere making a decision or that child making a decision would be that much more informed. That's all. That's my primary point.
Okay.
Jim Bosman, the Conway Finance Committee. What is the, so it's the per pupil cost here is this 13 and
let's
change.
Say 13.5.
How does that compare to the benchmarks in the rest of the state? Are we educating for less than other towns or for more, or what's that average?
I don't know if it's
said. Well, we don't have the end of the year reports were filed in September. We're still waiting back our data on that. So I don't have that information now. But as soon as it comes in, I will get that out to you. But I believe last year we were above the state average. But then we're going to get into the whole mess about all of the Frontier Regional acts as fiscal agent for all of the grants that come in for both Frontier and Union 38. Prior to me coming here, all the grants were reported on Frontier Regional, which was and it actually inflating our per pupil costs. So for the first time this year, the early childhood grants went to the four elementaries. The Title I pieces went to the four elementaries. The SPED 94-142 grant got allocated by all five schools. So this year I expect to see a big drop in our per pupil costs at Frontier, and I'm expecting increases in our per pupil costs at the elementary schools. And it is that per pupil cost that drives the charter tuition. And I think that's why our charter tuition is so high, because our per pupil has been overinflated by reporting all of the grant expenditures on that report.
Yep. One in the back.
You mentioned that for the first time this year, our choice numbers are upside down, which implies that we are receiving revenue for students who choose into the district, correct?
Correct.
Do we have that number?
Yep. It's on page 18. Okay, so the choice tuition revenue is projected at 878,160. The first number on the page.
Is there a number of students on that page?
No, it's based on 129 students.
Okay, good, thank you.
Yep.
Yeah, Patty, when we report student numbers to the state, school choice numbers of our students either choosing out or those students choosing in, who gets
we
credit
report
or charge?
The in, and the other districts report the out.
Okay.
So our reports of school choice in develops the school choice outs for each district. And DESE does that.
And the charter students, do we get credit for those? Or no. Even though we're paying for them, we don't get credit for that?
Yeah. It's almost analogous to EQB formulas that we get at the town level. Very similar, isn't it, Patty? In a lot of ways, it's a very similar formula.
Is. Which is frustrating.
Yes, it is. We share the frustration.
Right, and I can see why Deerfield is frustrated when they look at their percentage. But it's basically, again, based on the required minimum contribution, which is based on the equalized property value and the wealth of the community. And they'll argue those numbers aren't correct, or they should be updated more, which is true. I mean, I think we're using DOR numbers from 2013. Come on, it's 2016.
Patty,
a question. Are there activities or actions that you could do to attract more choice students that you haven't tried, that you haven't done, you don't want to do? Is there value in this school that you're not promoting as effective as you could or as competitively as you could?
But what would you be suggesting, Paul?
Well, I'm just off the top of my head, okay? You got one of the most successful girls volleyball programs here, in the Western, and probably in the entire state. Where are those girls going to school? Are they getting?
You can't recruit for MIAA. I mean,
Do what?
MIAA.
What?
We had two girls come here who were volleyball stars, come from South Avenue. They play here. MIA said they couldn't play the first year they were here.
Yeah.
Okay,
it's considered
the first
recruiting.
Year. Did they play the second year?
They had to sit out a year.
The point is, there are kids out there, and they look at this school as a place that might be a conduit to a college scholarship of some sort in some way, and we're not doing enough to promote that, then,
I would argue that we are, because we have 129 school choice students out of 600 students. So I would say we're doing a pretty good job.
Doing good. My question is there more? Well, is there more? Because I just heard he's got to draw four in for every one that goes out.
For charter. Correct, financially.
Because of charter, correct.
Right.
And I think that's, you really look at the numbers, we have more choice than almost two towns put together. So you start talking about the population of the school. So, the numbers are broken, you know what I mean? So, okay, when we get 20 other students, the numbers they're bringing versus the number I'm gonna change staffing to adjust, because, you know what I mean? You got to get 4-1. The cycle, that's where I don't know where the end of that cycle is going to come.
Right.
We have a new participant on the other side.
Dylan Corpita, Deerfield Finance Committee. I was actually going to ask the question what was just brought up, that it seems challenging to grow your way out, because as you get to a situation where you have an entire extra section or class, you're talking about a
$13,000 per pupil cost and a $5,000 per pupil revenue. So you're kind of going backwards, the disparity between the choice income and either special education or charter school costs. That's where it really seems to be a mismatch. And not so much for this budget, but with a 5 or 10 year horizon, what sort of ideas does anyone at the table have of what we can do to address it other than, I guess, legislatively?
I really feel that legislatively is where the change has to occur. I think we have adjusted everything on our end. I'm not saying there aren't other ideas, but we have really worked hard on this for the last 10, 15 years.
A lot of the ideas that you generate are based on population, and we don't. It's shrinking. It's getting smaller. Marty's point was dead on, that there's only so many fish in the pool, in the pond. And we're all trying to catch the same number of fish because the enrollment in all the schools and all the towns is going down. So the funding formula becomes even more critical. Equity in the funding formula becomes even more critical when the size of the pool we have to draw from, no matter how you market your educational program here, no matter how you market it, the size of the pool is shrinking.
And we don't want to get in the position, and it's not the same comparison because it's a secondary school, but Deerfield Elementary, for those of you who are involved in Deerfield, continue to accept many, many choice students, so that the number of classes, even though the population was going down, stayed at three sections per grade. When it became pretty much of a reality that third section was, for the most part, made up of school choice students. So what they've done last year and may do this year is not accept students in kindergarten to reduce the number of sections, because they were having to hire additional staff to deal with the students who were coming in as choice. And they were finding that the cost of hiring those additional staff, not just a classroom teacher, but instructional assistants and portions of art and music and PE and speech and all of that, far outnumbered the $5,000 that they were getting in for those students. So it is a real balance. The answer is not just to go out and get more school choice students.
Yeah, once they're in, they're in. You know, they're choice into your school, you take them through the matriculation. You can't, if you vote not to participate in school choice, they're already here. So they're yours until they graduate.
One of the things, though, that they're also doing here, and it has started to ramp up more intensively in the past couple of years, is work actively on recruiting our sixth graders to come here. The principal here is doing yeoman's work in that regard. And that's something, realistically, that there's always room for improvement, because we've been at around 75% average sixth graders going on to Frontier seventh grade for years and years, and I believe there's upwards movement possible in that number,
Are you talking just for Conway?
For Conway, that's what I know the best, but I think that's true district-wide. I mean, you know, even a slight uptick would yield important dividends in that regard.
Because the majority of our students in sixth grade do come here.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, so it's always been around 75.
Well, it's actually higher than that. Waitley and...
But you're also talking about private school. Conway gets a large number that go to the Charlemont.
You remember a few years back, I skipped, and John Pachurik and all those guys have been here for a while. Remember when we instituted a strings program at Frontier?
Yeah.
Everybody kind of looked at us like, you're adding a program?
Well, yeah.
Because there was a strings program in the elementary school. If you didn't have the strings program here, hasta la vista, baby. They're gone to a school with a strings program.
It was, you know, you need is
financially advantageous.
Yeah,
about three of them.
Right.
It costs us.
And there you paid for your teacher. So you institute the strings program to hold those kids back from choicing out or chartering out to a strings program.
Bill, it is the opposite. If you start going the route of, okay, so let's reduce our class sizes, let's reduce staffing and get rid of some of the school choice we have coming in, that means I got to reduce programming. That means, what are you going to cut? Well, I can't cut the core and I can't cut special ed. So I can cut the extras. And so what are the extras? Yeah. The arts, the things that are going to draw, now that's going to be a direct line to Pioneer Performing Arts. That's going to be a direct line to, you know, if I go into languages or whatever, you know, you create the vacancy, the other schools around us will create the programs to draw them in. So it's that, again, it's that balancing act as well as you try to,
We've done that here a lot with our SPED program. We offer programs in this building. We have students coming from other districts here to take that program, because it's cheaper for us to develop a program and do it here than it is to send them out. Dylan.
A different question on school administration, not specific to Frontier. Obviously, read things in the paper anecdotally over the last 5, 10, 20 years about a growth in administration costs for schools, whether it's testing or this, that, the other reason. I don't have the numbers in front of me. How do you guys feel about that trend, if there is one, over the last decade and what it looks like going forward?
For school administration, I can say we've added no positions in since I've been here in 20 years.
I mean, like as a percent of the budget, I guess, like percent of the budget going to teachers versus other big swaths, whether it's administration or other things. Do you see any other trends that you think bear mentioning the way that you did bring up the choice charter disparity?
I don't, you know, all I can do is all I can do is rail a little bit over things like that, because I went to school. I graduated in 1973. We didn't have adjustment counselors and 14 other kinds of counselors, because your family unit, people at home, took care of those things. The demise of the family unit in this society is what the school has become. We are required to provide everything for everybody because they're not getting it at home from, I was going to say from mom and dad, but a lot of times there isn't mom and dad. That's what's led to a lot of the administrative functions around here, is the paperwork, the programs, and what you have to offer in order to make all of this, all of it work together, because you don't get, kids don't get at home what I got at home. Simple as that. So yeah, exactly.
What about that, the sustainability, the long range planning committee and the study and all that? There was a committee that we looked at. We were going to look at ways to redo like the regional agreement for the capital like type of budgets and stuff like that. Where is that all at?
Mark Hamlin, who's heading that up from the University of Massachusetts. He's met with all of the select boards. He's now meeting with some individual directors. He's met with Bob Lesko in maintenance. I haven't had an update in a while. What you're talking about, regional agreement, was proposed during our regular meeting that the committee needs to look at for next year. That's sort of a separate thing. We still don't have language around capital expenditures, and I think that should be put into the regional agreement.
Bob?
I have different about your discussion about that, because he has never come to the town of Conway to discuss anything with us.
I was told that he had been to Conway.
Nope. He came in and introduced himself one night.
Okay.
And said, "I'll be back."
That was it.
And that's the last time we saw him.
Was he waiting for your special town meeting to occur?
Yes. Uh-huh. I think so.
Okay. Did Tom leave?
Yes, he did. I think, Mr. Baker, that's what happened, is that he introduced himself, but because you hadn't appropriated the money, he had put you last, so now that the money's appropriated, I'll shoot him an email tomorrow, and I'll get in touch with Tom Hutchinson as well and make sure that gets...
we had to go back for special town meeting and get the money.
Right.
Allocated. Calling dealings.
More questions? Doug's in the back. Look like you want to.
Yeah, I'm just thinking about it. I'm wondering if I should ask the question.
I will. Why not? I've heard from a few folks up in West County. My folks are in Shelburne. I know some folks still up in Shelburne and Charlemont and Ashfield, and I've got a brother living in Buckland. Their speculation is that 3 to 5 years down the line, Mohawk Regional District is going to be required or will be forced, just because of the overwhelming financial weight of that district, to consider consolidation of all students into a single facility, into the regional high school, K through 12, because of reduced student numbers and because of the increased cost of the facilities. Any thoughts 5 to 10 years down the line
There's a
about similar discussions here?
I think that was on the allowances committee, wasn't it, that was doing that?
Yes.
They're looking at excess space and capacity in all the buildings, because we all have beautiful, relatively new elementary schools that were built during the boom to house lots of kids
sure.
who aren't there anymore.
Sure.
So we're looking at space options and availability, because towns are crunched for space. Waverly was fortunate to come across a building to solve some serious problems in Waverly, but other towns have space problems too. So we're looking at schools and all kinds of ways to use sure. Excess physical capacity.
Yep. Okay.
It is being done.
All right.
Just to dovetail on that, Mohawk is sort of the gateway to what is happening in the Berkshires. The Berkshires population is being decimated. in fact, Phil told me tonight that one of the regional districts tonight had to cut half their staff. But it's because of the population decline. We are not seeing the dramatic population decline that Mohawk is. And I know they are trying all sorts of creative ways to sustain, you know, their programs. But they do have some buildings that are virtually empty. We are not in that situation in our schools. We don't have empty schools. And I think Darius has done a great job in trying to consolidate teaching positions and multiple certifications so that we have flexibility.
Yeah.
But I'm not going to kid myself and say that the population decline has gone pretty much as predicted in the last couple of years, except for the town of Sunderland. And I don't know if it's a blip on their radar just this past year, if it's a one-time wonder, an anomaly, or if this is a pattern. Everybody else is following that they're losing 3 and 4 students, and the birth rate is very small in our town, so that population is not there.
Waverly's birth rate last year was like two?
Two.
Waverly had elementary school classes that were they had more choice kids in them than they had native kids.
Yeah. Yeah.
And they still do.
And I know that that's going to be a really uphill battle, but and I don't have kids in a school, and you know, not from this area, so I can't even sit at the table, but I think the uphill battle is going to be one of the elementary schools may have to either share space with another entity or consider not being an elementary school anymore.
Volunteer for the next K-12 committee in the back row.
Yeah, yeah. Thanks, sure. Appreciate it.
He's making a big argument. Why not to go K-12?
But, you know, these are the hard discussions that everybody in the town has to have, because everybody in the town all four towns have to decide what they want their towns and their schools to look like. And I really don't think, I won't be here, but I don't think we can continue to do the same thing that we've been doing for the last 10 years and expect to get the same results.
The great challenge, too, is fashioning long-term solutions to these problems that don't create winners and losers amongst our four towns, because any type of change to the regional agreement that we're talking about has to be approved by all four towns, by majority vote in each of the four towns. So how does that get done if there's a loser? So
change your definition of lose.
Well, yeah, I mean, exactly. But the tough roads to hoe, regardless.
Yeah.
More questions?
Apologies if this is in the budget, because I do not have a copy. Is the issue of the resource officer brought up or addressed? I know it came up last week in elementary school conversation. I didn't know what had been talked about or thought through in this budget.
No, it hadn't been brought up because for our committee, we were approached at the Deerfield School Committee last week by the chief of police to see if we could find funding of $20,000. This was in the Deerfield Elementary and perhaps Frontier budget. And because of the last minute, I said the budgets have been done, and I wasn't sure how we were going to address that. I also have asked the police chief to get me descriptions of what an agreement would look like. I'm having a hard time envisioning what a shared person would look like between three private schools and two public schools. It's not that I don't support the concept, I just can't figure out how it would work. And I wish the funding request had come in before last week.
It's a bit of a conundrum right now, Dylan, that the towns are asking us to cut the budget, lower the budget, but add 20 grand per police officer. So it's like a mixed message.
And I know they've been a big support, and, you know, and that, like I said, it has nothing to do with a person who's currently serving in that role and how they've supported our schools. I just cannot quite figure out, A, how we would fund it, and B, what that agreement would look like.
How was it funded this year?
It was funded this year. I thought it when it was approved at town meeting last year that a line item from the town budget supported it. And I believe it was funded through the budget and through donations by Deerfield Academy. Is that correct?
Actually, last year it was proposed, it was not funded. The police chief took it on himself in Deerfield to actually create the position. He moved an individual from, I believe, a standard third shift position to the first shift position. Actually changed the hours that person worked from a 4-on, 2-off to a 5-on, 2-off position to allow him to synchronize his schedule with the school's schedules. He's backfilling the empty shift with per diem staff, with part-time per diem staff, to allow that individual who was on a third shift to work first shift to be available to the schools, both the private schools as well as Frontier and Deerfield. But it was after last year, it just wasn't funded.
Okay.
Can I ask one more question?
Sure.
This is just for clarification. It was mentioned earlier that there may be an additional $100,000 coming from the E&D to help offset the assessments to the towns, and that the numbers that we were given is based on that being approved. Is that correct?
Yes.
Okay. Straw poll, is that going to be approved?
Yes.
Well, they have to vote before
I figure they do, yeah.
We're going to be motioning that in a few seconds.
Takes a two-thirds vote, Doug.
What's that?
Takes a two-thirds vote.
Okay.
So,
it's not two-thirds, it's weighted, isn't it?
Still awaited two-thirds.
If there are no more questions, we will end the public hearing and go on to our other business, and I believe that is on our table. If somebody would like to make that motion so we can have a discussion.
So move.
Thank you all.
Can I have a second?
Thank you all very much for your comments.
And now discussion. Did Judy second?
I second that.
Thank you. The discussion on the 100,000? Bob did? And Judy seconded.
You won't have to roll call it.
I know.
I did.
Any other further discussion?
No more questions on it. I thought we explained it pretty well before what we were up to. So.
Yeah, I understand.
Hey, all those in favor? Unanimous? Good to go.
It's anonymous.
Anonymous? It's anonymous. I didn't say that. Bill did.
No, are you going to vote the budget number?
They just did.
They just did.
No.
We just voted the 100,000.
You voted the 100,000.
Now we're going to vote.
Now we're going to vote the budget.
According to the regional agreement, you need to adopt a tentative budget figure tonight.
Okay,
so
give us a number.
Okay, you would need to, and someone needs to make a motion to approve the transportation budget of $297,970.
So moved.
Second. That's just for transportation.
Yep. Yeah.
Second.
Yeah. So it's Bob and Alan. Any discussion?
I got it.
All those in favor? Okay. Bob did.
You would need to make a motion to vote an operating budget of $10,060,492 for operating budget in fiscal year 17.
So moved.
Second.
Oh no, you
can. Any discussion? All those in favor?
Yes.
All right. It was 10,060.
10,060,492.
1,060,492.
Okay.
There is no debt this year because our debt is paid.
All right.
Move to adjourn, Madam Chairman.
Do I have a second?
Seconded.
All those in favor?
Oh, yeah.
And we're out. Paid.